We're so lucky we actually have the playwright as well as the translator for this piece with us, Ivor Martinic and Tomislav Kuzmanovic are both here. And I just wanted to quickly introduce also Shira Milikowski, who will have directed the reading, who has directed the reading beautifully. So without further ado, I'd like to invite you to watch My Son Just Walks a Bit Slower.
Walks a Bit Slower by Ivor Martinic, translated by Tomislav Kuzmanovic. One.
Darkness. Anna, the grandmother, 70 years old, is sitting at the table. She knows she is in the dark, but she doesn't know why the light is not switched on. A long time ago, she used to sit at the table under the light.
Mia, her daughter, 50 years old, enters. She carries a plastic bag with two cups of yogurt. She's tired, even though she was taking her time. She was in no hurry. She walks slowly when going back to her house. She switches on the light. She sees where she lives. And then, even more tiredly, she sits down next to her mother. You've been in the dark again. They haven't switched on the light for you. You couldn't find it? Right there by the fridge, that's where you turn it on.
I'm saving.
You mustn't be in the dark. It's sunny outside. Streets are full of people, everyone's out.
And where's Slavko? It's been a long time since I've seen him.
He's dead, Mom.
Dead? And Nevio?
Dead too. He died last year. You couldn't go to his funeral.
And Oliver?
Alive.
Son of a bitch.
Mom.
Which one I ended up marrying?
Oliver, Mom. I brought us a couple of yogurts. Want one? You haven't had anything for breakfast. At least have a yogurt, huh? A yogurt? Go walk a bit then, Mom. You need to walk, that's what the doctor said. Come on, you'll feel better.
Anna stands up and walks, slowly.
Robert, age 50, enters. Good morning.
I'm sorry I cried last night.
I'm gonna go down to the kiosk to get the papers. He slams the door on his way out.
Was that Victor?
No, that was Robert, my husband.
Son of a bitch.
Mom.
And where's Victor?
Dead.
Dead?
Dead.
And Anta?
Dead.
Goran?
Dead.
Was it a fire or something?
No, Mom, you're just old, that's all. Come on, Mom, walk. You have to walk. That's what the doctor said. You'll feel better.
Anna walks, like an old woman.
Doris, age 20, enters. Bronco still asleep?
Yes.
Be nice today.
Doris. Mom, please.
Where's Dad?
Went out.
I'll go find him. I need some money.
Want some breakfast?
Breakfast?
Yes, if you want some, if you're hungry.
What?
There's yogurt.
I'll get some coffee at the cafe. Wait. You got an eye booger from sleep. Wait. There.
I probably missed it when I washed my face. How about me? You're good.
I'm pretty? There, now we're both pretty. All three of us. And Bronco, too, of course. He's got the prettiest eyes. See you later. See you later, Grandma.
Oliver, the grandfather, 70 years old, enters.
See you later, Grandpa.
See you later, sweetie.
See you.
I'll head down to the library and get the papers.
Robert said he'd buy it.
Just the same, I prefer to read the papers there in peace.
You're a slow reader because you're stupid.
See you.
See you later, Dad. Tired?
Tired?
From walking?
No.
When you get tired, sit down.
Anna sits down.
Mia and Anna are sitting. For a moment, you can't tell which one is older. He should have been up by now.
Let him sleep.
Let him sleep.
If only he'd fall in love.
Want something to eat? The whole morning you haven't eaten a thing.
I'm saving.
Bronco enters in his wheelchair, slowly. Good morning.
Good morning.
Who moved my wheelchair? It wasn't by the bed.
I don't know.
Maybe the draft moved it away.
Next time, just yell and I'll come help you. I don't mind. Mia kisses Bronco.
They say on the radio, it's nice outside. How are you, Grandma?
Well, you see, I'm old.
Could have opened the windows, let some sun in.
I will. There's yogurt. Want some?
No.
It took your mother the whole day to give birth to you.
You were a stubborn baby. I pushed and pushed, but you just wouldn't come out.
We waited for you a long time.
I had to walk around the hospital, small steps. The doctor kept saying, walk, you need to open, walk, you need to walk.
You were a beautiful baby. What a shame.
I'm going to the park.
You want me to take you there?
I'll manage. And open the windows.
Stay in the shade.
Bronco exits.
Anna and Mia say nothing for a while. They've forgotten something. Mia remembers, stands up, and runs to the door. And happy birthday! She opens the window. Happy birthday! Happy birthday! I gave birth to him yesterday, and today he's 25. 25 is half of 50. And 50 is half of 100, and 100 is eternity. It's so annoying that the illness picked him. It's so annoying. I still don't know what to get him. We paid a fortune for that wheelchair. If only he'd gotten sicker later, we could give it to him now. He'd smile and say, thank you, that's just what I needed. Now I can go to the park, push myself around, cuss a little, and feed the pigeons.
Fuck them damn pigeons. They don't need legs. Sons of bitches have wings.
Come on, Mom, walk. The doctor said you have to walk. Come on, it's healthy.
Anna walks. If only he'd fall in love.
Rita, Mia's sister,
and Michael, her husband,
are standing in front of the open door. They whisper to each other and peek inside. Rita holds a string of dozens of colorful balloons in her hand. We won't stay long, okay?
Oh, wait outside. Can I?
No, you can't. We have to wish him a happy birthday. We just have to. He's family. We won't stay long. Trust me. I won't trick you. I know you don't like being here. When I told my family I was getting married, Mom threw up. It was odd to see my own mom's vomit with meat and potatoes.
She never took to me.
Never! What's more, she hates you. Why lie? You're a grown man. She's not the only one who hates you. My father hates you too. I was a smart girl, and you were a salesman at a woman's boutique.
He shook my hand hard at the wedding.
By then he was drunk as a skunk. Let's go. We won't stay long.
We won't stay long?
We won't stay long. Rita and Michael, take a deep breath and walk in.
Ah, not here?
They're hiding somewhere.
Maybe they're not at home.
Is there anybody here? Is there anybody in this house? People? Hello? Where are you? Hello?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Rita.
Mia.
It's nice you dropped in so early.
We're busy in the afternoon, that's why.
You're busy in the afternoon.
We won't stay long. And you, Mrs. Anna, you look younger by the day.
Cut the crap.
Mom! Language, huh? And look how pretty you are. Let me give you a kiss. Rita walks to her mother and gives her a kiss. Jesus almighty! When was the last time you washed your hair?
Let it be.
Come on, Mom. Let's give you a shower.
I showered.
Not this month, Mom. You didn't. Not this month. Rita and Anna exit. Balloons in their hands.
So what is it you're doing in the afternoon?
Something we can't postpone.
You don't want to come to the party?
We're busy.
You've been avoiding this house like it's cursed. Back when I celebrated my birthdays, you used to come and watch me as I walked around in the nicest dress that could be found in your boutique.
It's been a long time since then.
It has, so what? Time has passed, so what? Time passes. Time passes because it has to. It can't stop, right? It can't. I'm still a pretty woman. Men still smile at me in the street. And you still think I'm pretty, right?
You're getting prettier by the day.
Cut the crap. You'll come to the party. It's my son's 25th birthday and we need to celebrate.
I'll have to talk to Rita. She's been tired lately.
I'm tired too. My ears are buzzing from exhaustion. And I smell. The older I get, the more I smell. Just like this house that's decaying in its own rot instead of becoming a museum.
I'll talk her into coming.
And tell your son to call Bronco and wish him a happy birthday.
I've already told him.
He hasn't called.
He'll call in the afternoon.
How's he doing?
He's managing just fine.
You talk to him every day?
Yes.
It's not easy for him to be so far away.
That was his choice.
Has he got a girlfriend?
I forgot her name.
He goes through them so fast, so many names. That's all right, he's young.
Bronco's gonna find someone too.
Just tell him to call him. In the house at the party, there will be too many old people. He has to call.
Okay.
Rita and Anna enter with balloons in their hands. There's no shampoo. So I brushed her teeth.
Okay, let it be.
I didn't mean to say that you're not taking good care of her. I didn't want to imply that you're lazy. She just smells. She's old, that's the way things get. You're taking good care of everything. Mom, what did you have for breakfast?
Nothing.
For God's sake, Mia!
I bought her a yogurt, she didn't want any.
Mom, you need to eat. Are you hungry?
Yes.
There, please. Give me the yogurt, I'll feed her.
Mia gives Rita the yogurt.
This one's not good. It's for children.
It's the only kind she likes.
She's not a child. Right, Mom? You're not a child.
No, I'm not. I'm old.
Rita feeds her mother. Who is not a child?
We forgot the present.
I only took the balloons upstairs. I've completely lost my mind. I no longer know where my head is. My head is like this balloon, the pink one. Michael, the present's in the car. We'll get it.
Franco's not here.
No? Where is he?
He went to the park.
Really? It's nice that the park is so close.
They redid it nicely. I just saw it from the car. Are they fucking around that park of yours? In mine, the fucking starts already at 10 in the evening. Everyone's fucking with everyone. Men with men, women with women, and the usual kind, of course. It's just horrible. In the morning, when I'm walking my dog, I can't even let it off the leash to do its business. It momentarily bites into a condom, and that's not good. You have to be careful about AIDS. It's a terrible disease. But it's nice during the day. The park is nice. I'm sure it's nice to while some time away.
Yes. Well,
it doesn't matter. We'll leave him the present here. If we called him back now, it would take him at least a half hour to come back in that wheelchair of his. That wheelchair is really clumsy. I was just talking to my son. I asked him why he doesn't spend more time with Bronco when he comes to visit. He says, "Mom, I love Bronco, but that wheelchair of his is so clumsy. I'm not a patient guy, and the wheelchair is clumsy. Gotta pick a movie at the theater that has no steps, and then restaurants where there's enough room between the tables. And then there's the taxi, and you have to fold the wheelchair, and it all costs money."
He's got a better wheelchair now.
A wheelchair is a wheelchair, it's just clumsy, my son tells me. And then all those people who just can't stop staring. I mean, I stare at those that are different from myself. There's no malice in it. It's just that what's different somehow attracts you. And it was really neat when he had the crutches. Then you couldn't tell whether he just broke his leg or just walks a bit slower.
Can't use the crutches anymore.
That's why I say it's a pity. When you saw him with those crutches, you thought, what a nice fellow. Well, he broke his leg, but he'll get better. I hope he likes the present. Shops are full of all kinds of things. It was a pain to choose. Michael, go get the present from the car.
Maybe it would be better if we came later. In the afternoon?
We're busy, we can't.
The party is in the afternoon. Yeah.
It's something we just can't postpone.
Michael, go.
Michael, stay.
Mia.
Rita.
Let's not argue.
Cut the crap!
The party is in the afternoon and you'll show up for it. My son is turning 25 years old and you will be here, okay?
We've got a lot to do if we want to make it to the party. I have to take the cat to the vet. It's been lazing around the house these past few days. I'm worried it might drop dead on me. Those animals die so quickly. Their time is different from ours. You never know when they might just drop dead on you. We should have bought a parrot. They live about 100 years old, but you can't have a parrot and a cat. And also, how are you going to get a parrot? What if it doesn't grow on you? What if 20 years later, you realize you don't like the parrot? If you don't like what it says, what it has heard, and what it keeps repeating, what then? Parrots can't leave. You just can't open the window and let them fly away. Where would they go, for God's sake? We're not living in a jungle.
I'm sure the cat will be fine.
I don't know. We'll see. It would be a pity if it dropped dead on me. You've seen it. It's a nice kind and has those three little white spots between its eyes. If it dies, I won't find another one like that. We'll have to take it to the vet right now, since we have to be here in the afternoon. How long do canaries live for? Maybe we could get a canary. A green one. We've never had a green animal.
Let's wait and see.
Yes, silly me. Maybe it won't drop dead after all. Maybe it's just tired. I also get tired and often think I'll die, and yet here I am, still alive. Let's go.
See you in the afternoon.
See you.
See you later, Mom. Please give her a bath.
Goodbye. Mia sits down next to Anna, who is still holding the string of balloons.
You like the yogurt? Are you still hungry?
No.
Are you sure?
I'm sure.
I'll make a soup, and then I have to go buy the present.
Okay.
Rita's lost weight, hasn't she?
I don't know.
Yes, she has. You can tell, don't lie. Fits her nicely.
Yes.
Michael's good to her. They tolerate each other nicely.
Good for them.
I know you never liked him.
Rita was a smart girl.
And I was pretty. Look at me now, Mom.
It's fine.
Nothing is fine.
Yes, it is. It is.
Nothing is fine.
If only we'd fall in love.
Come on, go walk a bit. The doctor said you had to walk. We all need to walk, that's what the doctor said. Come on, stand up. Let's go walk. Mia and Anna, who is still holding the string of balloons in her hand, walk. For a couple of moments, you can't tell who walks more slowly, and who's the mother, and who's the daughter.
Two.
Sarah, a friend, 25 years old, and Bronco are sitting next to each other. Sarah on a chair, Bronco in his wheelchair. Thanks for keeping me company while I'm waiting for your sister. It's really nice to wait with you. I'm sorry if I talk too much. Your sister's really nice. Many people love her. Me, not so much. Maybe because I'm not as pretty as her. What? I'm not pretty, and I'm big enough to know it. It's just the way it is. Just as you're in the wheelchair because you can't walk.
You're pretty.
And you can walk. See? There's no point in lying. But don't think for a second that I think I'm ugly. No, I have nice lips. I'm skinny. And sometimes, from a certain angle, I'm also pretty. But at the same time, I'm not pretty enough for someone to tell me I'm pretty, let alone tall enough to be a model. Just as you don't walk well enough not to need a wheelchair, or crutches, or a cane. Some girls can be models, some can't. All of them can become doctors if they study hard, love blood, money, and saving lives, but you can't do too much to become prettier or taller.
Doris should be done soon.
I always pick what I'll wear in advance. Black suits me. It's strange that there are colors, and that we can choose them, and that they make our faces then look different. You don't have too many friends. That's also strange. I've sent you a friend request on Facebook so many times, but you just won't accept my invitation. You won't and you won't. There's so few people waiting with you. We can't be alone.
Who told you that?
We just can't. How would you get to know who you are if there are other people? You can't say good afternoon or good morning to yourself. You have to say good morning to someone. And if you don't, how will you know that it's the morning?
Doris, come on!
You don't have to do that. Let it take your time. Here, my lips are sealed. Silence is really nice. Nice. Okay, just one more thing. All I want to say is that we can't be alone or silent forever, which is what you'd like. That just can't be done. Okay, maybe it can. I haven't tried it. It's not my strong suit. But what's the use of words, letters, lips, teeth, tongue, and all those other things if we're keeping quiet?
Doris!
Who would you call if you were alone?
Doris!
I just want you to talk to me. We can't be alone. For whom would the colors exist? Who would lie to me and tell me I'm pretty if there weren't for other people?
Neither pretty nor ugly would exist then.
It would be a shame if pretty didn't exist.
Doris! Sarah's been waiting a while.
I'm sorry. I'm on the phone.
I don't mind.
birthday, Sarah. Cheer him up.
Marcus,
it's not a secret.
I didn't know. Then, I also have to give you a kiss.
My big brother is turning 25 years old. I'll get you a nice present, but I still don't have enough money. I can't catch up with Dad. He's been running around this whole morning. Sarah.
Yeah, who's on the phone?
Who?
Tin.
Tin?
Yeah, someone gave him my number. Can you believe it?
Don't let him wait.
I'm sorry. It's just that maybe I'm a little happy.
Actually,
I'm vulgarly happy. And it's your birthday. I'm sorry. Sorry. Doris exits. She may be a little happy.
Happy too.
Why?
For her. It's so hard to find a boyfriend these days. There's so many jerks around. Sometimes, when I'm walking around town, I catch them staring at my boots. There, you glance at them too. But that's only because they mentioned them. You're different. Maybe because you spend so much time alone. Most of them are only interested in sex. Sex is the whole world. Wherever you turn, someone's having sex. You turn on the TV and someone's having sex. You buy bread and someone's having sex. That's kind of yuck, so much sex. Which is kind of. Yet again, you can't go without it, right? If there weren't for sex, there would be no children, and there would be neither the world nor the earth. And yet again, bleh. Just like some children are kind of yuck, just like the earth is kind of yuck. I didn't get you anything for your birthday.
It doesn't matter.
I didn't know. Otherwise, I would have gotten you something. Why haven't you told me? I've been coming to your house for weeks and sitting with you, yet you haven't told me anything about your birthday. You don't like birthdays. I don't celebrate mine. I hide and lie that I'm sick. Few people remember that it's my birthday, so everything goes well. My birthday's in winter, during flu season. It's easy to catch it, and my immune system is weak. What can you do? I'm so embarrassed I haven't gotten you a present.
It's fine.
If you had a Facebook profile, I'd know it's your birthday. And then I'd say, happy birthday, with a ton of exclamation marks, and I'd like the photo where it's just you in it. That always makes me happy.
He wants to meet me in 15 minutes. Oh, it's so silly of me. It's your birthday, Bronco. Please forgive me. Can you hear it? Wait. Wait. Now. The butterflies in my stomach. They're flapping their wings hard, hard, hard. There. I'm sorry. But I'll get you a present. I found such a wonderful present for you. I just have to catch Dad before I get it. This whole day he's been running around somewhere. A wonderful present.
Your sister is very pretty. I love pretty people. I have nothing against them. Some are pretty, some less so, some not at all. And that's the way it is. Your sister doesn't like me, but I'm not gonna give up. Even the prettiest of people get bored sometimes, and they need someone to go to the movies or have a cup of coffee with on a Thursday afternoon when it's raining. It's hard to be alone, and we're alone so often, especially you. And we can't be alone. I tell you, join the Facebook, and you'll see millions of lonely people who are just gathering around themselves because they cannot be alone, even though they're lonely. And then we share things, thoughts, sentences, everything, just to show we're alive. Should we send you a friend request?
Thanks, but no.
But it will be easier.
No.
Stupid of me not to get you a present, but I didn't know.
Fine.
Doris enters. She looks so beautiful that everyone is embarrassed. I'm sorry. If I stay a second longer, all the butterflies in my stomach will stop flying, and I'll fall down, break my neck, and drop dead right here on the spot. I can't die today. It's your birthday.
I shouldn't have worn gray. Gray doesn't suit me.
Are you sure you don't want a drink?
No, thank you. You're so kind. And I'm embarrassed because it's your birthday, and I didn't know. I would have gotten your present, something nice, but I didn't know.
It's okay.
Give me your hand.
Why?
Because it's not okay that I haven't gotten your present. Close your eyes. Sarah puts Bracco's hand under her dress.
You're not wearing panties.
They don't fit me.
You're not afraid?
It's just your hand.
You're not afraid of me?
No.
And now?
A little. But I like to be a little afraid. Just a little.
And now?
Just a little.
Bronco removes his hand. Thank you.
You're welcome. Had I known it's your birthday, I would have gotten you something else.
I need to go to the toilet.
Franco, come here pretty again.
You're pretty.
Thank you.
Bronco exits.
Mia and Robert are standing in the front of the entrance to their own house, even though they often forget that this is their own house.
Just as they forget that they are husband and wife.
Where have you been? Look at the time.
I got caught in town. You?
Went shopping.
And?
I couldn't find anything.
A shirt, maybe. Or shoes?
Plenty of shirts. Shoes last him a long time. Maybe you're right. Maybe shoes.
Mia, please.
No, I'm fine. Really, I'm fine. I even got really happy at Michael's boutique. I bought a new dress. Want me to show it to you?
I'll see it tonight.
You don't see well in the evening and you quickly fall asleep. Want me to show it to you?
You really couldn't find anything for
it? Nothing. Maybe we could go for a walk. Just down the street, the stores are full of all kinds of things. We can just look at the windows. Just because we're getting old doesn't mean we can't hold hands. At least to keep each other from tripping over.
I'm tired.
It's a nice day. We don't have to hold hands. Our hands would get all sweaty for no reason. Please.
You were always better at picking presents.
There are too many things to choose from. I don't know anymore.
Well, here, take more money.
Please.
Robert gives her a huge amount of money and exits.
Robert, wait. Robert!
Bronco re-enters.
I love you.
Sarah.
Oh, screw it. I love you. I shouldn't have said this. I know it. But I love you. That's the way things are. And do what you want with it. I don't know if I love you because I love you, or I'm just in love with love, but, well, I've said what I've said, and that's that. I could put my arms around you and hold you all day long, nothing else would matter. I love you because I love you, and maybe a little because I love love. I wouldn't hold you too tight, just as much as you find comfortable, but I do it all the time. I'm sorry you don't love me, but I love you. Sarah puts her arms around Brown constantly, but all the time. I love you because I also need you, so that my days pass more easily. I'm not saying this because I'm selfish, but because such is this world of ours. And without love, you can't live in it. You just can't. I've tried. And don't worry about it. You'll love me too. You just don't know it.
Sarah.
If I start to bore you, well, we'll end it, and I'll leave it. I promise, many people left me. I know how to forget you. I just need to take long walks in the park, take deep breaths, now think about you, tear old photos of us, and then time will pass and I'll be fine again. I love every part of your body. It's every inch, every molecule of your scent. I'm telling you all this because I don't want the things that can happen. Not anymore. Everyone is lazy. No one feels like falling in love, and I really want to be in love with you, and I want to shout and yell, I love you! There! Now you know that I love you, and you see what it'll do about it. I'll come back this afternoon for your birthday party. I'm sure you'll have one.
Sarah.
I know. I'm a bit too much. But I'll come to this house in the afternoon. People are so sensitive on their birthdays. They're sensitive when they're getting old, because when they're getting old, they're dying. And we're getting old all the time.
It's going to be a small party.
It wouldn't be polite to make a big party. I'll wear a blue dress. Blue suits me sometimes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sarah, it's you. Am I interrupting something?
I'm just leaving.
I don't mind, stay. I'll just need to leave this dress here, and then I'm going back out to catch some air and to get a present. And to tell my son I love him so much. I've been in a terrible hurry the whole day, and I didn't tell him that. I love him so much I could pop like those balloons that pop when there's too much air in them.
It's so nice to hear this, that a mom loves her child. Huh. And it's also a little sad.
What's sad about it?
Well, the balloon that pops. I'm going. I'll be back in the afternoon.
Afternoon?
For the birthday party. See you.
I haven't even offered her a drink. So few people come over that I forgot. Is she bothering you?
No.
She's such a bore. If you want me, I'll tell her not to come to the party.
No need for that.
She's strange. She talks a lot, says all kinds of things. She's really strange.
There's all kinds of us.
Don't look at me like that. What is it? What have I said? I just said I'll send her packing if she's bothering you.
She's not.
Are you sure? I don't mind. Don't think I have anything against her. I just don't want her to bother you.
I haven't said anything.
If you like her, I don't have a problem with that. What I mean is that it would be nice if you had a girlfriend, but maybe it doesn't have to be her. I know what kind of girls you like. I know what kind of magazines you buy. You don't have to be ashamed. Such girls will come too. When you decide to go out among people more often, I'm sure you'll find a girl like that, one that's careful about what she says and how she acts. If you want me to like her, I'll like her. You're so difficult to talk to.
I haven't said anything.
It would be a shame if she ruined your 25th birthday party. When I was 25, I don't remember anymore. It was such a long time ago. And look at you. You're a quarter of a century old. A quarter of a century, that's a lot. An awful lot. Oh, wait, we haven't taken one picture today. We need to have a memory. Mia runs to get her camera.
Bronco doesn't like to have his picture taken.
Maybe I could take your picture by the window? Come on, let me help you up. You can stand by the window. You can lean against it.
Mom, I'm tired.
Come on, I'll help you. It'll be a nice photo. We'll send it to our relatives. Come on, stand up.
Take a picture of me as I am.
Just one photo by the window. It's such a nice day, huh? Every year we take your photo by the window. It would be a shame to break such a tradition.
Mom, I'm tired.
Mia takes a photo of Bronco.
Did it turn out okay?
So-so. The light's right behind you, so you can't see too well. We'll take another one later on, when you're sitting by the sofa and eating your cake. Everyone will gather around, so it'll be happier.
Anders. Good evening.
It's not evening yet, Mom. Are you hungry? I'll warm up the soup.
I don't want any.
You have to, Mom. You have to. Mia exits.
Where is everybody?
Who?
Your friends.
They're not here.
They died in the fire?
No, Grandma, I'm not old.
You're not?
You're old.
And where are your friends, then?
The fewer people around me there are, the better I walk.
I forgot that you don't walk again. It's a shame. And it took your mother a long time to give birth to you. There was this Victor. Have I ever told you about him?
You have.
He's all a blur somehow. I don't know if I loved him. It's all a blur. He was good in, how do you say it, in the sack.
I know.
He wasn't handsome. He was somewhat ugly. But he knew his way around the bed. He had strong arms, and he'd hold me in his arms the whole time.
I know, Grandma, you told me.
Yes, I told you. But I no longer know anything else but that. I remember only that he had strong arms and that he held me. Did I love him? I didn't. I've forgotten it all.
You loved him.
You think?
You loved him a lot. He's the only thing you talk about ever since you got sick.
What else do I say about him?
That he took you on a journey.
Journey? Where would I go?
Around the world. He bought you fur coats, jewelry. He was rich.
No, come on.
Yes, and you really loved him.
Sounds like a wonderful man, that Victor.
Yes.
If only I haven't forgotten him. And where is he now?
He's dead.
Fuck! Did I cry a lot?
I don't know.
I must have when I loved him so much. It must have hurt. Good thing I forgot that.
If only birthdays could be forgotten.
They can, but those around us fuck it all up. They remember. You know I know that you're lying to me a little, Branko.
I know, Grandma.
And you know I know he never took me anywhere.
I know.
But we're pretending a little.
A little?
Just a little. So that it gets easier. If only you'd fall in love.
Mia enters and puts a pot of soup and a bowl in front of Anna.
I'm going to take a shower.
Be careful you don't slip. Shout if you need help.
Branko exits.
Mom, eat.
I'm saving.
Come on, please. You haven't eaten anything. No one eats anything around here. We're people. We need to eat. We're people, aren't we?
It's a shame.
Come on, Mom. Please eat. At least you have to eat something. Mia runs away.
Have you turned off the stove? Don't forget to turn it off because of the fire. Those fires get going just like that. Damn fires. Everything goes up in flames.
Who are you talking to?
What's it to you?
There's no one here.
You don't see well.
You're stubborn.
And you go fuck yourself.
Stop swearing, please.
And you go fuck yourself, you motherfucking son of a bitch.
You didn't used to swear like that.
I don't know. I don't remember.
Well, I do.
Maybe you never heard me. I keep forgetting things. That's why I swear. They told you I was sick, right? I forget things, so I forgot I don't swear.
See, you can talk to me nicely.
I can when I want to.
Where is everyone?
They left.
You want me to give you some soup?
I'm not hungry.
Oh, come on, you need to have some soup. I'm sure it's tasty.
I'm not hungry. I don't want any.
Well, there, it's not completely cold.
Anna doesn't want the soup.
Well, I'll feed you spoon by spoon.
Anna doesn't want the soup.
It's right here in front of me. I don't have to feed you. Here's a spoon.
Anna attempts to pick up the spoon, but she can't.
Here it is. Pick it up.
Anna picks up the spoon. She misses the bowl with the soup and spills it all over herself.
Here, let me...
No!
You're spilling it all over yourself. Now, let me help you.
No!
You're spilling it. Hold on.
Leave me alone! Let go! Go home! Who asked you to come? I know how to eat the soup! You son of a bitch! Go home! Leave me alone. At least I can eat on my own.
Oliver starts to leave quietly.
Why are you sneaking around? If I keep forgetting things, it doesn't make me deaf or blind.
I don't want to upset you.
That's an illness, Oliver. You do understand that, don't you?
Yes.
I know you're having a hard time. It's not easy for me either that you're getting on my nerves so much. But what can I do? I'll be better tomorrow.
You never know.
Are you sorry, Oliver?
Because you're sick?
No. Because you're alive.
What can I do about that? Well, I'm going to the park and have a walk. I'll be back later.
All right, go walk.
Do you need anything?
It's strange that even though I no longer know anything, nor do I know what I used to know, it somehow seems I've never heard those words from you. Do you need anything?
I don't remember.
You don't remember. Who's sick here, Oliver?
I'm going.
That's what I remember well.
Mia enters wearing her party dress. You swore at him again?
A little.
Don't swear too much in front of him. That gets to him. You went through so much together, that's not fair.
What did we go through together?
All those years.
I don't remember them.
You couldn't have forgotten all of them.
Maybe they weren't important.
Mom, you spent your whole life with him.
Well, maybe he wasn't important.
Mom, I think you should be quiet now. The doctor said that too. Keeping quiet for a while is good. That's what the doctor said, it's healthy. Today is one of those days where you forget things a bit more than usual, but tomorrow you'll remember everything. All those years and the nice moments and why you loved Dad. Tomorrow you'll know why you're with him and not with Victor, Slavko, Ivan, Igor, Goran.
It must have been a terrible fire.
Everything will be clear tomorrow, Mom. No, just be quiet for a while. And walk, Mom, walk.
Anna walks.
It fits you nicely.
You're back. Thanks. You like it?
Yes.
Do you remember the first time you told me a dress fitted me nicely? You just said what you said and I dragged you behind the garage. What can you do? I was pretty and stupid and I never needed a lot of courting. It was easy to be young. The whole world was before us. Everything seemed possible. We didn't know that then was the future and everything that came after that was the past.
I loved you so much. I love you so much.
And I'd just love it if you came with me to get that present.
I'm too busy.
I'm nervous. It's our baby boy's birthday.
Everything will be fine.
I haven't even made a cake yet.
There's plenty of time.
I don't know how to be his mom.
Mia!
Maybe I want you less, but I need you more. Please stay with me. Don't keep leaving me like this all alone for days on end. We just need to hold on a little while longer, and then once again a time will come when I won't need your love. I'm not with you to be happy, but to be unhappy more easily. We love, or we did love, or we will love each other. Who can even know at what time or tense or whatever? But I need you. I needed you, and I will need you. How are you? It's me, Mia. How are you?
My back hurts.
I'll give you a massage.
Robert sits down.
Mia massages his back. Or maybe she's killing him. It's hard to say. Better?
I don't know. Still hurts.
Here?
I don't know. Now it hurts more.
Mia massages his back.
I've remembered Victor. Where's my Victor?
He's dead, Mom.
Victor gave good massages. And he was good
at... I know, Mom. In bed.
Yes, in bed. I loved him.
I know, Mom. Leave us?
It hurts.
And Nevio? Where's Nevio?
He's dead, too.
And Goran?
Dead.
Slavko?
It hurts.
Dead, Mom. They all died.
Was it a fire or
no,
something?
No, Mom. You're just old. Better?
It hurts.
How about now?
You're hurting me. You're pressing too hard.
That's how you do it. You need to press hard.
You'll mess something up.
And Victor? Are you sure he's dead?
I won't. I know what I'm doing. That's how you do it. That's how I'm massaging Bronco. The doctor showed me how.
Now it hurts even more. Stop, please.
Maybe he's not dead. Maybe he's just hiding.
It'll pass. Is it better now? You have to press hard. That's what the doctors told
me.
It
hurts.
Maybe he'll show up at the door, and then we'll realize that we made a mistake. And all of this is one huge mistake. How else can you explain all this? All those deaths and fires. And all the things that are being born, and this time.
Now? Better?
It hurts! Let go of me!
Mia massages!
One of the balloons Rita brought. No one knows why. Sometimes they simply pop from too much air.
It popped.
I'm going to the park to have a walk. Open the windows to let the air in.
Mom, are you tired?
From what?
From walking.
No.
If you're tired, sit down.
Anna sits down immediately.
Mia sits down next to her.
they said.
Balloons should be blown slowly so that you don't get tired. And then you should tie them tightly. But nevertheless, after a while, the air goes out. I don't know how. If it doesn't go out, they pop. There, that I haven't forgotten.
Mom, be quiet for a while. There, you haven't eaten anything. You're not hungry?
I'm saving.
You don't like the soup anymore?
The soup? I don't know.
You don't even know that there's soup in front of you?
Okay, maybe a little.
It's done. It's cold now.
I haven't eaten anything.
All right, I'll warm it up.
What kind is it?
Mushroom.
Mushroom?
Yes.
I don't like mushrooms.
Yes, you do, Mom. You do.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do. It's just that you've forgotten.
I would never forget
you
that.
You forget your husband's name. How would you not forget if you loved mushroom soup or not?
Son of a bitch.
What now?
That's my husband's name.
Mom, be quiet.
If only we'd fall in love.
Three.
Mia is sitting at the table.
Doris enters. She turns on the light. She sees where she lives. And then she sits down, tired. You're in the dark again.
I'm resting.
You mustn't be in the dark. Where is everyone?
They left. They have things to do.
You've been crying. Doris wipes the smeared makeup off her mother's face. For a moment, you can't tell who's the mother and who's the daughter.
Leave it. Let me do it. Where have you been?
At a cafe with some boy.
It's Bronco's birthday. You need to spend some time with him. It's not easy to be alone all the time. You never think of that with that pretty head of yours. I was just like you. You're having a nice time, enjoying yourself. You'll always have it easy.
I like that boy. His name is Tim. He's very handsome. We were having coffee, and then he touched my hand with his little finger. Briefly, just for a little moment.
What do you want me to say?
I just want you to try and be a little happy for me.
What color is his hair?
I'm sorry.
We'll be fine, you know. We just need a little more time to recover from that illness of his, and then I'll be happy for you.
I know. I'm just a little sad. I'm falling in love, that's why. I'm scared. That's okay, right? How not to be scared of something that's just beginning? Who knows what will come later? Is that when some things are just beginning, I think of Branko and I feel scared of that illness that fell upon him unannounced. I didn't ask anyone. It just fell upon him. That's the one thing Mom might not understand. Why him of all people? Why those big, beautiful blue eyes of his? How can you know who else is going to take, and how can you choose a person who will be dear to you when you know something like that might happen again? So unannounced, so terribly rude, and you know it will hurt so much. I know it's not the day, nor the place, nor the year to ask all these questions, but I have to.
It's all right. See, I bought this dress, and I'm happy. And all because of the dress. It fits me nicely. Michael gave me a discount and a coupon for the next thing I buy. And they also have a prize contest. It's a new thing at the boutique. Maybe I'll win a prize. I'm going to change. I don't want to get my new dress dirty. Some things need to be saved and used moderately. Nice dresses. Love, tears, and things like that. Go,
Go see that boy. Go catch some air.
But I have so many questions. There's so much
just
I need to know.
Just go.
When will you be my mom? You will be better. Mom!
Go see Tin, go. Mia closes the door after Doris.
Rita opens the door. She observes Mia. They look at each other. Hello.
Hello. Sit down.
So I came early.
That's nice of you.
Ah, what else can I do? Do you need help?
No, I don't, thanks.
Not even to set the table?
Cake's not done yet.
It's not?
I threw the first one away and we're mixing another.
I meant to bring one, but it's a nice day. It would melt in this beautiful weather. My cat's okay. Doesn't have cancer.
Sorry, I forgot. I didn't even ask how it was doing.
Never mind, it's all right. I thought it would die, but it didn't. Come February, it'll go mad again. I don't like letting it out much, but I'll have to. You just have to let it out to at least get laid.
And how's the dog?
It's fine. Wasn't pleased that the cat doesn't have cancer, but what can you do? It'll get used to it.
How did you get here?
We drove. I saw a car crash, still shaking.
Anyone dead?
All I saw was blood. Lots and lots of blood. Cars are, when you think of it, so fast. They can go so fast, and they're so insecure. I mean, by God, is there anything on wheels that is safe? Is there anything that goes around in circles that is safe? Not even the earth is safe. It's round, earthquakes all the time. The earth used to be a flat plate. Back then, there weren't any cars. Everything was safe.
And where's your husband?
He went to have a look at the new park.
They redid it.
Yes, so you said. It's nice they redid it.
Yes.
It's somehow quiet.
They're having a nap before the party and Brooke showering.
He can do it all by himself?
Yes.
That's nice that he can do it on his own. If you also had to help him have a shower, that would take too much of your time. And it's good that the bathroom door is big. That's nice, so we can pass through it. And when you think of it, it's nice that you all live in a big house with wide doors. You can't sleep?
I ran out of pills.
Which ones are you taking?
Valerian.
They are no good. I discovered a new kind. They just invented them. I made a reservation on the internet. They ship them from Canada. Fantastic. Rita opens her bag and pours out thousands of pills.
You and Michael are fine?
We're managing.
I'm glad to hear it.
Yes.
You look good together. There was a time when you didn't look so good together.
He's gaining weight lately. He eats a lot. I tell him, don't eat so much, piggly pig, but he doesn't listen.
Strange that you're married. We all thought you'd never get married.
Me too. I was smart.
And ugly. But unlike me, smart and talented.
I could have traveled the whole world. That's how smart I was. And as ambitious as I was ugly.
So why did you get married?
Why did I get married? Why do you ask why I got married?
sometimes. Late at night, I watch TV. Something about mummies, about the bad Chinese, zombies, and I get scared. Then I go to bed and I hug my husband firmly. That's why I got married.
Because of bad Chinese people?
I don't know, maybe they were Japanese.
Your son called. He talked to Bronco.
We told him to call.
That was really nice of him. I'm sure he's got it good.
He has.
He works in a different town.
He does.
He wears a suit and tie.
He does.
And he walks. My Bronco walks too, just a bit slow. He's good, my little boy. And see, I haven't even managed to bake him a cake. And you have a husband who's looking at parks and a child who's got it good.
My baby boy called last night. He got a raise and tickets for 3 new journeys to faraway lands. He's talented and ambitious. He takes after me. He's already seen all the continents and he's so young. He called to tell me that. And I didn't know what to say. His success doesn't bring me as much joy as it used to. I no longer know why.
He hasn't forgotten you, Rita.
I know he hasn't. I'm forgetting him. And it's not a problem that I'm forgetting him, but that I like it. He irons his shirts better than I do. That little egocentric jerk.
He's okay.
Oh, I don't know. Luckily, I got my dog and my cat. They're smaller, and they're happy about you until they get cancer or drop dead. And a canary, too. I think I'm gonna get a green one. You can get a sturdy cage these days. I don't think the cat will eat it, and even if it does, what can you do? I'll get a blue one. I've never had a blue animal before. I get along with animals really well. I think that's because we don't speak the same language.
You'll need to give me those Canadian pills.
Sure. I spend a lot of money on medication. If only I could pray to God and believe. It's cheaper, but it doesn't work for me. Have you ever tried?
I never found it convincing. But you know what helps?
What?
Well, before I go to sleep, sometimes I imagine just for a little that my son is walking.
That's nice. I also sometimes imagine things. My son's gay. There, I've said it.
How are you?
Fine. It's not easy, that, being homosexual.
No, it's not.
But then I'm thinking, he's not crazy either.
Michael?
I haven't told him yet. I'm waiting until he pisses me off. So I can yell at him. Your son's a faggot! Your son's a faggot! Maybe he gets a heart attack and dies. You never know.
You never know anything.
No, you don't.
Anna enters. She's looking for something. I can't find that fur coat Victor bought for me.
He never bought a fur coat.
Yes, he did. Branko told me. And he took me on a journey. Lots of journeys.
Mom, stop. Come here, let me kiss you.
Rita kisses her mother.
Where is he now? Victor?
He's dead.
Dead? Was I sad?
Only after a long time when you found out. You said you left him.
Left him? Why?
You went back to Dad.
Why would I go back to him? I never loved your father.
We don't know, Mom.
Why would I go back to him? Victor was the only man I loved.
We don't know, Mom.
You're lying. You lying little bitches. You're lying, and I gave you everything.
Calm down, Mom.
You're lying. You lying little bitch. Shut your mouth, Mom. You keep talking about that Victor ever since you got sick. Stop it. If he hadn't died, do you think that would have been love? Where is love? Where does it live? Love, where are you? Love! Love!
I only saw it on TV. It lasted some 180 episodes, and that was it. The main character's wedding, and poof. Darkness. The end of program. Why don't you already stop talking about love, Mom?
If only we'd fall in love. Son of a bitch. Anna leaves.
Rita follows her.
What happened?
Mom's going on about Victor again.
You need a hand with anything?
We're okay. Dad, do you regret, now that you're old and you'll soon die, do you regret that you married and had all this? Dad, that was a question. Do you regret having all this? Do you regret marrying Mom now that she's so sick?
I'm old, I don't know.
Come on, you can tell me. You're old, you'll die soon, I won't tell anyone. Tell me, Dad. Do you regret having a family now that you're this old and about to die? Do we mean anything to you? We, these empty shells all around you, ugly and stinking? Does all of this mean anything to you now that you're so old and about to die?
What do you want from me?
Well, just tell me, is it worth it? Is all of it worth it, Dad? This, that I'm crying for Bronco, that it hurts so much. Do I have to do it like this, or should I just stop worrying so much about the pain that we're all gonna die just like you? I mean, you're already old. You're just about to die. Maybe you're already dead and you haven't told anyone. And in all those years, I've never learned anything from you, and you'll die, and I never will. Dad, is living worth it? Mia puts her hands on his shoulders. There, at least I touched you. Let's go find you a tie for the party.
It's a 25-year-old's birthday.
Nevertheless, let's go. Mia and Oliver exit.
Bronco enters. He looks around and sees where he lives.
Anna approaches him. She cried a little. I can't find that fur coat Victor bought for me.
Maybe it's in the attic.
We don't have an attic.
We don't have an attic.
Yes, it must be in the attic. A moment ago, I remembered everything again.
What?
There was no Victor.
What you remembered is wrong. Don't think about it like that. You talk only about Victor ever since you got sick. How could there be no Victor, Grandma?
There was no Victor. No. I made it all up. There's no Victor. He doesn't exist. I had a boring life. It's no surprise I forgot him. That life just kept going and going. And I thought that maybe something would happen, but nothing ever happened, and then I made up what I made up. I lied a little, and then when I forgot everything, the only thing I didn't forget was what I lied about. Because what I lied about was the most beautiful. And Branko, don't tell Oliver about this. Anna exits.
What's wrong?
Nothing. Grandma.
She's having a tough day today.
I suppose so, yes.
I wanted to tell you that if you ever feel like you want to tell me something, you should know that you can. I'm fine. I can take it. I just wanted to tell you this so that you know, whatever you need. So, I love you. I haven't bought you a present yet. I no longer know what you want. You're growing up and your beard is growing out so fast you need to shave every day. Maybe I should get you a shaver or something. I love it when your face is soft like a baby's tushy.
You've got me enough things.
Nonsense, we don't mind spending money on you. Tell me what you want.
Nothing.
Come on, don't be so modest. You're terribly modest, so much so that it's annoying. It's your birthday, we have to get you a present. I have to go to the stores before they close, and they'll close any second now. Do you want to come with me, pick something for yourself?
You know I can't go fast, and you'll be in a hurry. The stores are open for another half hour.
I don't know if I'll have enough plates for the cake. Sarah's coming?
Yes.
Maybe she won't want cake. And if she will, we'll give it to her on a plastic plate.
Sarah loves me.
I can take the plastic plate.
I don't love her.
Then we won't need any plastic plates. Why bother for no reason?
I don't love her, but she loves me, and that's just fine.
What are you saying?
I need to practice this life a little longer.
You deserve someone much better than her. Much better. Don't look at me like that.
Mom, forgive me, I can't walk. I can't walk. I will never walk again. And that's just the way it is. It's very simple.
All of this because I'm your mother. Your illness is my illness, except that mine's more difficult because unlike you, I can walk.
I know.
But I'm better, trust me. Today I didn't cry so much. And I don't tell the neighbors that you can't walk, I don't tell our neighbors that you just walk a bit slower. See how much better I am? This morning I went to the store and I said it was your birthday and the cashier asked me how I was and how you were and I said you were fine. I said you didn't walk at all, but you were fine. That you no longer walked a bit slower, but that you didn't walk at all. And he looked at me with sympathy, but I was proud I could say it. You do not walk, you drive.
Oh.
What? Didn't you want me to say that now that you're sick? There you go, I'm saying it. You can't walk. My son doesn't walk. His legs do not work. He will never walk again. I can say it. There, I've said it. I'm sorry.
It's okay, Mom. Let's talk about something else. Come on. Tell me about my second birthday, when I learned to walk.
You are such a beautiful child. Really beautiful. You made your first steps there by the fridge. In the beginning, you kept falling, but you'd get up instantly. I'd hold your hand a little, and then I'd let go, but as soon as you realized that I wasn't holding your hand, you'd fall. And then slowly you stopped falling. And I no longer had to hold your hand. And ever since then, you've been running as far away from me as you could.
In my 20th?
I took you to a dance club. Everyone looked at you strangely as you tried to dance, but I wanted you to be like everyone else. So I danced with you.
And the almond cake?
The bitter cake. I guess the almonds went bitter. I was so uncertain I could have flown into the air, but I didn't know if my cake was really bitter, because when I wanted to taste it, it was gone. You ate it whole. That's how much you loved me. I know I've got to let go. I know I've got to.
It's all right, Mom. We'll take it slowly. I love my life. It's not that I don't. I love it that I am the way I am. At least I know I'm alive. And I love that Sarah loves me, and that's just fine for now.
Mia takes her camera and takes a photo of Bronco.
How'd it turn out?
It's good. It's a nice photo.
Well, I haven't worn this tie for 30 years.
They're back in fashion. I've seen it in the papers.
Oh, I look ridiculous.
Mom, tell him he looks nice.
You're talking to me?
Yes. What does Dad look like?
Nice.
There you go.
Okay, if you say so.
Shut up, you son of a bitch.
You woke me up.
Oh, there are so many people here already. I thought I was late. It's such a beautiful day outside.
It's really sunny today. Hello, everyone.
I'm so clumsy, I haven't done anything yet, and the time just flew by. Everyone, let's get ready for a party, huh? Bronco is turning 25 years old.
You're getting old. My dear brother, you're getting old.
They scatter around the house. Everyone wants to make the decaying house look better.
Robert approaches Mia. Mia, I haven't told you.
What?
My back doesn't hurt anymore.
Jerks, how smart they are. They just live for a day. Someone for one day, someone for 1,000. Everybody drops dead in the end.
Before that happens, let's take a picture. Robert, a family photo, come here. Mia gives her camera to Michael. Mia puts her arms around Bronco, who's sitting in his wheelchair.
And Robert puts his arms around her.
Mia turns around as if something is missing, and then she notices Doris. Doris, come here.
Doris joins them.
Michael takes the photo.
How did it turn out?
I didn't manage to fit you all in the photo. But it turned out fine.
Fine.
Four.
Sarah Bronco, Tin, and Doris are sitting and having a drink. The decaying house is decorated with balloons. It's the end of the party.
Tin, how old are you?
28.
You had your birthday last month, right?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. I saw it on Facebook. You really have a lot of friends. You didn't put any photos on Facebook. Did you have a party?
Yes. At a bar. Just down the street. I got so drunk that evening. Oh, I've never gotten so drunk. Horrible. I kept throwing up the whole next day and the day after. Hey, do you want us to go down to the bar? It's still open, and even if it's not, I know the owner. He'll let us in.
Well, we could.
No, it's better here.
Where? It's so cool from your folks that they went to sleep at midnight and left us alone.
They're funny.
I wouldn't bet my mom is an eavesdropping on us somewhere. Doris gets up and, turning on her heels, watches around the house looking for her mother who's hiding somewhere. She looks behind the door. She looks under the couch. She looks behind the refrigerator. She's not here.
Does anyone want another drink?
Your folks have a fantastic taste in alcohol.
So, whiskey.
The same, yes.
Doris and Sarah pour drinks.
Some bitchin' wheels you've got there, huh?
Yes, it's a good wheelchair. Relatively new.
One of my friends is in a wheelchair, too. Those things cost some big bucks.
Yes, they're expensive as hell.
But it's good. It looks nice, too. Let me see. Can I? Tim takes Bronco for a spin around the room. Look how it slides.
Oh, come on, Tim. Stop it.
What?
The tires are top quality. It's not hard to drive.
Yes, it's really good.
Hey, do you know what we need? Some music. Can I?
Put on whatever you want.
Sarah goes to put some music.
That's good. Let it play.
Sarah comes back and sits in Bronco's lap.
Tin stands up and offers his hand to Doris, inviting her to dance with him.
Oh, no. Don't, please.
Come on. What's wrong?
I don't know.
Come on. You love to dance, and now when a guy's asking you to dance, you don't want to?
Oh, come on, Ollie, please.
Why are you so embarrassed? Come here.
Just for a little.
Doris and Tin are dancing.
Sarah and Bronco are watching them dance. Sarah gets up from Bronco's lap and takes his hand.
Bronco stands up.
Sarah puts her arms around him, firmly and permanently.
A hug. End of play.
First of all, again, I think a round of applause for the actors. It's stunning, so much about everything, of course, is casting, but so much is also about the play, right? So, which we sometimes forget. Tell us a little bit about the play.
Well, the play was commissioned by Zagreb Youth Theatre in 2011. And I wanted to write a family play, basically, about the family and what family is. And especially the families in Croatia, which is like a very traditional kind of country, where people are really stick with the families, and we have lots of rules, and everything matters in the family. And during the decades, I mean, the family changed, and I think now there was a referendum in 3 years ago, about marriage, and there was a referendum, should it be in the constitution of the Croatia? And they vote yes, as a marriage to be relationship between a man and a woman. And it was a really kind of, it was interesting to see this process in Croatia because of the how eager the people were to protect the marriage and to protect the family founders in this traditional kind of war. So this was about it. This was about really to see what is the family today, where is the, you know, not so hard points of it, in it, or where is the, yeah, what the family really is.
I think, just to put them in context, and I hope I'm not misinterpreted. First of all, we all have to know this is a play that comes now out of the Balkans. It's a Croatian play. You know, the references, you know, the big fire, things that loom over these dark, dark clouds. There's all this pressure cooker of a family where everything can pop and explode and every a minute. Of course, highlights, you know, all the situation that perhaps a country finally is able to focus on itself. So it's not in the tradition of Eastern European plays, you know, which used to be communist propaganda plays. A lot of it afterwards perhaps were absurdist plays or plays, you know, like the UNESCO's and others where we say they don't make any sense, but that was actually what life was about. That was, you know, it reflected life. And then this idea of a discovering, I think, of inner worlds, of a family, and being perhaps happy that this is the biggest problem, the family that we have now. But still, there are these, there's this history that is lurking over them, and it reminded me of that old joke where someone said, you know, what's a pessimist? And it was, I think it's an Eastern European description. What's an optimist? And the pessimist says, things can't even be worse, and the optimist says, yes, they can. And so, but still, the family, I think, you know, in a way, they at least try to stick together, except, of course, for the brother who was absent. But tell me, is this for you also a play about a political play, about your situation, about the country, about your feelings, about the future, and so much where it will go? Or is it an examination of love?
Well, I mean, it is a political play in the way of what is the family today, because it is changing. The definition of the family is changing by every decades, and so in that way, I think this is a political play. And of course, it's have this feeling of the family in transition, where the traditional kind of ways and traditional kind of rules of the families are getting aside of the new political systems or economical systems. So yeah, in this way, I think this is a political way. In this way.
Yeah, it's also, I think, reflecting the kind of the loneliness and the loss. And they're hard. They can't believe in God. I mean, they cannot really believe in a party system or something which you don't really go into. But it was such a strong. Oppressive presence, you know, what was life supposed to be about, what about to make you happy and not happy, and I think you really try to understand that, and also to show what is falling apart, but also some of the beauty of these very honest relations, uncensored thoughts that come here when they are almost ghosting. So tell us, but is that, I don't want to be pop psychologist, is this your mom or your grandma, but is it a combination of things? Is this a typical play you write? Is it about family and human situations?
I started with writing documentary kind of theater. I mean, plays based on the documents and the facts. And then this was like commissioned for the big theater, and they have like a ensemble of actors. So I wanted to write like a big play for lots of people to be in it. And I knew this actor, and I wrote it for them in a way. And I think it's also, yeah, I mean, it's of course there is some autobiographical moments in it, and but it's also the way how the Croatian people, I think, they speak in this kind of very without censorships. It's a very direct kind of a way we share the things. And in English, sometimes you have a feeling like we are avoiding something, and in Croatia we are very direct, and it's not like an aggressive kind of direction, but it's kind of way how we talk to each other, and sometimes, especially in the families, we are really honest to each other, and sometimes we can say really horrible things in our families, but we do know that we do love each other. And from that, this kind of style came out with being really trying to find the truth in every sentences and in every topic that I'm trying to.
Yeah, I think you really, communicate a feeling, perhaps, how it must feel to be in that country or in Zagreb, mm-hmm. with that kind of past, which nobody really knows anymore, doesn't want to talk about, the uncomfortableness of being in the present, not being able to deal with, and not really knowing what will happen in the future, how will the lives be of those young lovers and young people, and the uncertainty of it, I think it gets very close to our emotions and minds, and I think we all connect to it. As a director, to you, what, because that was beautifully directed, so many air and pause in between, so it's not so easy often to get messages in a bottle from a different place, almost Europe, sometimes in America, seem to be like two different stars, and we think of values and what it's all about, but how was it for you to work with that text?
Yeah, it's a couple things. One is definitely the comedy is always a challenge, and this I've done, of course, other plays in translation, and there's this sense of, okay, we know that it's funny, but cultures interpret and write comedy so differently. So for me, just hearing it presented to the audience for the first time, there's so many things you think, oh, that's funny, and that's also funny, and we can go back and make that funny. And it was fun to see where the comedy came out, but I think the play deals with so many intense personal issues, but there are lots of moments where it's not just, I think in America we tend to connect comedy and lightness, but that in this play there's comedy with darkness, and that's the thrill of it, and that can be equally comic. So I think that's a gap that we were working on and crossing over and crossing back. And then the other side of it is actually the opposite. It's this intense relatability that I found in reading it and that we found in working on it. More than in other rehearsals I've had, I found myself saying, oh, well, this reminds me of my family in this way. My family's sitting over here. It's weird.
It's live streamed.
They're nothing like these people. The actors started joining in and say, oh, yeah, well, we were dealing with sickness in my family, and this happened. And so that there's this core, as much as there's a cultural gap, there's also this really core truth inside how family members are stuck together and need each other and push each other and pull, and that's universal. I think we found that immediately.
Yeah, I loved the reading. You could really hear every word, and you didn't really know what happened. Like, what would the next sentence be? Which I always think is great theater, great comedy in a way, very serious and darkness. But also, I think every character had dignity, and you were laughing with them, not about them. And I thought they really you felt for them, for everyone, even for the cat. it was not fair, you know, to die on the birthday, but coming to the pills and Canada, which was also that wonderful moment when all the sense of a wheel is lifted and all the pills come out, you know, where you see different layers, you know, of what you talk about, what do we do, what do they do, what we all do to survive and to be to not kill ourselves right away, since even so we will drop dead. But the pills came from Canada. So tell us a bit about the challenges of the translation for this, and what you did to iron it out. Or
Ivor and I discussed he asked me how was the work on translating his play, and I said it was easy because it was well written, and that's how it always goes, you know, when the text is well written, then it's not difficult to translate it.
What do you mean by well written?
Well written, when you know they're always. I guess translators are the closest of close readers, I guess. And then you find all those little bumps when the writers are struggling with, you know, delivering either the line or the sentence, depending on what you're translating. There weren't that many places in or any at all in this text. The challenge was, maybe we've seen it a little bit here, that, you know, Mikhail became Michael, and Rita became Rita, and so on. When I was translating it, I thought that it would be very easy to replace these names by, you know, some more American names or something like that, and that maybe the play would be, you know, it would simply work better for the audience. But then Ivor said, no, we have to keep it this way, and he wanted actually to, maybe, I don't know, maybe the most difficult part was keeping this aggressiveness of the language, or I don't know, maybe the swearing a little bit and so on. I guess that if, you know, we wanted if I wanted to polish it more, I would probably tone it down a little bit. It wouldn't be such strong words in a sense, because I guess, I don't know, I mean, you're the American audience, but you can you know, feel for yourself whether this was just a little bit too much or not. I mean, it's not like when we talk to each other in Croatia, maybe we are going to say something like that, but it's not as bad, right? It's not.
You don't really mean it.
No. So
no,
that's it. Yeah.
No, I think it was a fast-moving Croatian family train that was a wreck or not. Or no, we don't know where it's going, but I thought it was very fluid, very musical, and you're right, there was very little fat in that play. It was very trim, and I could feel that you worked and wrote a lot about it. But we have so many great theater people also in the audience, and part of our work here at the Segal is really to engage and to have you. We always say we really need good theater, but we also need a good audience, and we really appreciate that you come out in the middle of the day or the end of the day to come and listen to plays and voices from around the world, from people you most probably never have heard. But what is important to us, so for you to remember, these are not, you know, often they're emerging playwrights and people saying they should come here and you workshop a play and maybe get down. No, these are really masters of their field, of their craft on planet Earth. And so it's a real honor, you know, that you also came here. So here's a chance to say something. We have a microphone, not only so we hear better, so also it is being recorded. So, yeah, please.
Yeah, it seems like in Croatia they deal with disabilities very different than they do in America. You seem just to like accept it as it is in America. We'll see it as a problem. Oh, if you have a mental illness, you need to see a psychiatrist. And you have a disability, you need to see have physical therapy. And I'm saying, do you see any differences between how America sees disabilities or illnesses? And did you want to put that and say something about that? Because that seems to be a major part of your point.
Well, maybe you can. I don't know about America. This is my first day in America, so I don't know much about it. But I can say that in my country, while I was writing this, there was on the street, I saw the one guy and his son who was 2 years ago, 2 years old, and he put the finger to the guy who didn't walk, and he told to his father, look at this guy, look at this guy, he don't have a leg, and his father took him in his arms and saying really terrible things to him, like you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't talk like this, you shouldn't put the finger to this guy, and this kind of stuff. And this was really wrong. This is wrong attitude to do it, because all he need to do is just to leave the guy, to leave the little boy to accept these differences, and just not to put aggressive and not to put that there is something wrong with having seen this kind of people on the streets. And this is something that in Croatia we don't do. We don't have in our kindergartens, we don't have disabled people who will come and introduce themselves to the small kids, we don't have all this kind of politics that will introduce, integrate people the disabled people with kids, and which is the most important period in life to be aware of this. And yeah, that's Croatian part of the story.
You know, I'd say when Ivor and I had one Skype session about a month ago, and just I asked him some questions about the play, and one of the things that you talked about was the character of Mia and this, you said it was a particularly Croatian character, this powerful matriarch figure who wants to control something, and then her son has an illness and she can't, she really can't control it. And I really just looked at the disability through the lens of that, in terms of, I didn't know if this was this is how all Croatian people are handling disability, but I thought, because I don't know any other Croatian people, hello. But I thought, okay, let's see how this family has this issue that is spinning out of their control, and the play is this magnifying glass to look at how each person is dealing with that. And what's really striking to me, this is veering way off your question, is it's clear to me that there seems to be a stream in the play that the young people are okay with it. Even Branko himself seems kind of okay. And I don't know if this relates to the political situation you're referring to. It seems like the older generation is trapped and struggling and can't accept and wants to control. Like Tin shows up at the end and he's like, oh, can I wheel that thing around? It's cool. And which I think is at the root of the hopefulness inside the play.
Yeah, and in a way, what you say, with the premise of the play, we all want to know what is love real, what's really love. We all want to die. And but in a way, they all have disabilities, and we all have disabilities. I mean, everybody of the character, you know, the one who was the most obvious, of course, the one who's the, you know, who couldn't really walk. Any more? Yes, please.
Thank you. I'll start by saying that how wonderful the direction for the reading, and the actors were really great. I have a desperate need to share something here because I'm from Croatia too. I'm actually a friend of a friend of yours, and I haven't met him before. And I don't know about his work because I've lived here for 20 years. But I also lived back there when it was before the war, Yugoslavia. And I have a strong desire to counter what you were saying about the importance of the political dark cloud and also the sense of some oppression that's still kind of squeezing onto people. And I will tell you, because I know both worlds quite well right now, like the East and the West, it's a kind of an old-fashioned idea that keeps limiting how we live and how we are perceived. There are no good and bad worlds. Yes, that country has its past, and the past is a little dark, but people have really, I mean, more than a little, but people have moved on, and what they are dealing with, which I think is wonderful in the direction, it's universal, it's a family, is my son gay, it's the disability issue. Life is not easy here. This country is dealing with such tension, racial tension, for example, the institutional racism. So I get a little like worked up when I hear that, you know, over there in the East, there are all these issues as if we are, and we are not stunted by it. We are as complex, as wonderful, as fucked up as anybody else. So this is a set which gives you that picture, but I really just wanted to say, take it out of the politics. Look above and beyond it.
Yeah. True. Still, but on the other hand, I mean, Le Haye just had one of the war criminal trials was just concluded. Mm-hmm. So it is such a significant part, and I guess we all often live in our world, and we said, when we lived in Berlin and there was the wall, we said, who cares about the wall? Doesn't affect us, you know. But it, of course, was such a big thing. But I also think you're right. You know, it's a universal message, and this is really. And I think this is why this play is important. That I try to say that it does not focus on that, or so it's really a step trying to portray whatever is normal in quotation marks.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with. I mean, in the way this was the reason why I wanted to keep the Croatian names, and why I wanted. I always told him I don't want it to sound like American. I mean, I don't want to sound like. It's not translated. I wanted to have a feeling like it's translated, because I think that it can be put on, I mean, it can be like read as American play, but it is Croatian play. This is the way why we should accept each other, and having a wider look at this between looking only at political levels.
Yeah, so I think we are coming to the end of the session. The next play will come. I think it was a great play, and actually I was in Zagreb like 1 or 2 years ago. It's a fantastic town. People are out on the streets, mm-hmm. in the cafes, and celebrating life much, much more, perhaps, you know, even because of what we imagine and as a happier country than others I visited in the last years. So you really brought us a great snapshot of life there. So thank you all for coming.
Thank you very much.
And I hope you will come back for the 6 o'clock meeting and 8 o'clock meeting in 10 minutes or 15 minutes. So we have to thank you all. Always to clear the space.